we welcome you to La Casa de Cristo Lutheran Church, where our mission is to love those who don't know Jesus Christ and grow those who do. Thanks for staying connected. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Whoa, check out the view. I am so excited for this year's Vacation Bible Experience, Above the Treetops. Kids ages 4-year-old through 6th grade are invited to join us on this great adventure as we dive into the Bible together. We are also in need of adults and youth to help us make this week a great success. You can find out all of the information on lacasadecristo.com/VBX. And we can't wait to have every single one of you join us on this grand adventure. Hey, Paula, what do you have going on?
Thank you, Stacy. I too am so excited that it is spring here at La Casa de Cristo. I'm Paula Webb, and I'm the Director of Women's Ministry. I want to invite you to our next spring women's event. Now, I wrote it down for you to tell you and teach you what it's going to be, ladies. It is Bring Go, literally Bring Go. What is it? It is brunch, it is bingo, and it's bring all your friends. So the name is going to encourage you to go and bring all women, all ages, all faiths here on Saturday, May 11th from 9:30 to 11:30 in the Gathering Place. We are going to have so much fun. Whether you're a junior high girl or a great grandma, anyone in between, all women, all ages, all faiths, welcome here. You're going to receive an invitation, start handing them out. Go and bring to Bringo.
Well, thank you, Paula. That Bringo sounds really, really interesting. And speaking of Bringo, next Saturday is our Veterans Breakfast, our April's breakfast. It's April 13th, this coming Saturday. So Bringo your friends. Actually, if you're going to bring them, please have them register. Our speaker this Saturday is Lieutenant Colonel Ed Logan. He is an Air Force colonel. He is part of OSI, Special Operations, Special Investigations. And we start at 7:30. The coffee is on. 8 o'clock, we will start our program. And 9 o'clock, he will begin speaking. So you do not need to be a veteran to come. Please join us.
Well, if the word Bringo shows up in the dictionary in the next month or so, we know who to blame. I love you, Paula. Sorry. Well, good morning. So happy that you're able to make it here today. We had a wonderful Easter last weekend, and we're here to continue celebrating the Easter promise that Jesus gives us every single day of our lives. I invite you to stand as you're able or as you're willing, and we're just going to lift up the name of Jesus this morning.
I raise a hallelujah in the presence of my enemy. I raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me.
I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. In the middle of the mystery,
As we come to you today, we are so grateful for the opportunity to come and worship you and this Easter season. As we gather, be with us always. Help us to always focus on you and the fact that you have risen from the dead. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Grab a seat. I'm going to invite the kids to come on up here with me at this time. So if they want to come on up here, that'd be great. Come on up. How are we doing today? Come on in. Got a few more. Come on up. Want to get everyone up here. I want to show you something. Pastor Jeff got a sports car, all right? Now, this sports car costs $7 at Walmart, okay? I'm going to have you move just a little bit back, okay? Just a little bit, because we want to see what this does, all right? We're gonna go over here and see what these guys are doing over here, all right? We're going to check on them. Then we're going to go backwards, all right? Oh, crash into the wall. Oh, Pastor Jeff's not a good driver. All right, here we go. It fell off the steps in the big church, you know, that's the way it goes. All right, but pretty cool, huh? How am I controlling this car? How am I controlling this? How does it work? Yeah.
A controller.
Yeah, but how does it work? I mean, do I just wave this thing and it works? What do you think happens? Yeah, you're right. Okay, so there's batteries in here, and there's batteries in the car as well, all right? But you know what? There's an invisible signal that goes from this to the car. And in just a few minutes, you're going to hear Sue read for us a lesson from the Bible today in which Jesus was invisible even when the people were right in front of him. And you know, the cool thing about God is this, even when we can't see God, even when we can't see Jesus right in front of us, there's still power there. Just like the signal, there's always a power there, and we can always hold on to that power. So we're going to have a prayer together to celebrate that today, and I ask as I pray that you guys repeat after me. Big kids, you can repeat after me too. Dear Lord, we thank you that you are always with us, even when we can't see you. Help us to remember your power is always there. Even when it's invisible. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. I want to thank you guys and gals for coming up here today. You're really awesome and appreciate you. And as you head back to your seats, I'm going to invite everyone to share in the peace. And when we're done with that, we're going to grab a seat for our morning offering song. But after the offering's received, you're welcome to stand or sit as you want. So let's move out of our seats, greet a new face, and share God's peace with each other. Thanks for coming up, guys. Appreciate it.
Your name is healing. Your name is mine.
in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name of Jesus. Shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus for my family, I speak the holy name.
Seated this morning as Sue comes up to read the scripture for us.
Good morning. Our gospel this morning is taken from the 24th chapter of Luke, beginning with verse 13, and it's found on page 749 in the Sanctuary Bibles. Now that same day, two of them were going to a village called Emmaus, about 7 miles from Jerusalem. They were talking with each other about everything that had happened. As they talked and discussed these things with each other, Jesus himself came up and walked along with them, but they were kept from recognizing him. He asked them, "What are you discussing together as you walk along?" They stood still, their faces downcast. One of them, named Cleopas, asked him, "Are you only a visitor to Jerusalem and do not know the things that have happened here in these days?" "What things?" he asked. "About Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "He was a prophet, powerful in word and deed before God and all the people. The chief priests and our rulers handed him over to be sentenced to death, and they crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one who was going to redeem Israel. And what is more, it is the third day since all this took place. In addition, some of our women amazed us. They went to the tomb early this morning, but didn't find his body. They came and told us that they had seen a vision of angels who said he was alive. Then some of our companions went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said. But him they did not see." He said to them, "How foolish you are, and how slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Did not the Christ have to suffer these things and then enter his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. As they approached the village to which they were going, Jesus acted as if he were going further, but they urged him strongly, "Stay with us, for it is nearly evening. The day is almost over." So he went in to stay with them. When he was at the table with them, he took bread, gave thanks, broke it, and began to give it to them. Then their eyes were opened and they recognized him, and he disappeared from their sight. They asked each other, "Were not our hearts burning within us while he talked with us on the road and opened the scriptures to us?" They got up and returned at once to Jerusalem. There they found the 11 and those with them assembled together and saying, "It is true, the Lord has risen and has appeared to Simon." Then the two told what had happened on the way and how Jesus was recognized by them when he broke the bread. The Gospel of the Lord.
There are four key words in that gospel that Sue just read for us. Four key words that I want to focus on today because it has to do with us and with our hope. And those four words are, "But we had hoped." But we had hoped. That's what those men said to Jesus on the road to Emmaus. When Jesus walks up to them, and of course they don't recognize him for who he is, he's asking them, "What's been going on in Jerusalem?" And they say these words, "But we had hoped." Past tense. They were looking for the military Messiah. They were looking for a Jesus who would deliver food to them and social services. They were looking for a Messiah who would get rid of Roman oppression. And when Jesus came with a very different agenda, he gets nailed to a cross, and their hopes and dreams are gone. But you see, the disillusionment that people experience when our dreams are shattered, when things break apart in pieces in our lives, that's not just limited to first century Palestine, because you and I, we've used the same words or similar to them, "But we had hoped." We pray for a loved one who may be ill, may have cancer, may have ALS, may have some other disease. We pray for them and we say, "But we had hoped they would just remain healthy, that they wouldn't get this disease." We pray for a certain situation in our lives. Maybe it's a family dynamic that we feel out of control over, or maybe it's something at work, or maybe it's something going on in our retirement years, and we pray and pray, but it doesn't seem to get resolved. But we had hoped for a different outcome. With over half of marriages in America ending in divorce, couples try to work out their problems. But then the day comes when they don't get worked out and the divorce papers are served. But we had hoped that this marriage would thrive. But we had hoped. We could go on and on with different examples in your life and mine about that. Maybe we have different hopes and expectations of dreams of a spouse or parents or children or grandchildren, but those dreams turn into disillusionment, turn into heartache, some sort of pain in our life. And that's why it's so important that as we come on this first Sunday of Easter, we understand that those four words, "But we had hoped," apply to each and every one of us. Even pastors. Every pastor all around the world this Sunday is saying this, "But we had hoped that as many people would be in worship this Sunday as there were last Sunday." But we had hoped. Our business is planting seeds. And we know that the people that may only come at Easter and Christmas, that there's something there, that the Holy Spirit's working on them. And we do have them come back. Maybe not all of them, but the reality is God is always up to something and we are called to plant seeds. But you see, hope is not a word that should ever be used in the past tense. not for people who believe in the risen Christ. Hope is not a word that should be used in the past tense. Certainly you can do that grammatically. Certainly you can do that according to the English language. But hope for a believer in Jesus Christ is not something in the past tense. When we say words, but we had hoped, then what we want to do is we want to give it all up because we don't believe in that risen Christ anymore. With Christ, there is always hope for the present and for the future. No matter what we're encountering, no matter what's going on with us, no matter what our setbacks and drawbacks and challenges are, God is always using that setback as an opportunity for a comeback in your life and mine. And that's what we need to see, know, and feel and understand on this first Sunday after Easter. That what we celebrated last Sunday wasn't just the celebration of a festival. Oh yeah, sure, maybe the alleluias are a little more muted today, and maybe there's less people, and we didn't have our beautiful Easter garden in the main sanctuary for our three other services this weekend. But the reality is for you and me, that as we come here today, hope is never a word that should be used in the past tense, not for those who call Jesus Christ their Savior and Lord. Why is that? Maybe a story will help us understand that. There's a young man in his 20s named Taylor Brownlee, who lives in Colorado. And Taylor's father was a sheriff's deputy for a small community there in Colorado, and he was chasing a criminal another number of years ago and ended up losing his life in a shootout with the criminal. He left behind a wife and two small boys. Taylor was old enough to really connect with his dad. He really loved his dad. He loved the legacy that his father had left, and his death was very hard on him and, of course, the entire family and community. And about 5 years after his dad died, the sheriff's department there in this small town in Colorado, they were getting a new fleet of cars that were coming in. So they were selling all the old cars, and Taylor's father's old Dodge Charger came up for sale. And he wanted to bid on it and buy it and own it. So that was a legacy and would be a legacy from his father. Well, Taylor had a job, but didn't make a lot of money. His friends and family became aware of this, and they started a GoFundMe, and they were able to put together about $20,000, and the day of the auction came. The day of the auction came, and the bidding began at about $5,000, but soon it soared, and it soared all the way past the $20,000 mark, and you could see on Taylor's face tears streaming down his cheeks that he was not going to be the one that was going to be able to get this car and have the legacy of his father. The bidding finally ended at $60,000. And afterwards, the local farmer, who was pretty well off, went up to give his check to the auctioneer, and then he took the keys. And he walked over to Taylor, and he put the keys in Taylor's hands, and he says, "This is for your dad. This is for your dad." You see, Taylor could not pay the price. He could not pay the price, but someone else paid the price for him. And that farmer walked out. He refused all interviews, all press. He refused all recognition because that was the gift of grace given to that young man in honor of his father. He couldn't pay the price, but someone else paid it for him. And that's what we celebrate this day. That's what we celebrated last Easter Sunday. That's what we celebrate every weekend here at La Casa, that someone else paid the price. Our father's legacy to you and me, our father's legacy is this, that he paid the price for our sins. He paid the price for our brokenness. He paid the price for our defeat, our disillusionment. And so we understand that hope's never in the past tense. Hope is never something that we should have in the past tense. Hope is always about the present and the future because the price was paid for us. And you know, it really doesn't depend, folks. It really doesn't depend on what's going on in our lives, good or bad. It doesn't depend on our circumstances. It doesn't depend on how many people are in church on any given Sunday. It doesn't depend whether this happens on a Sunday in April or whether it's a Sunday here in July at La Casa, a hot Sunday when half of La Casa de Cristo is in San Diego. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. Because the reality is for you and me, God's always there. And that leads us to our second point for today that I think is very, very important to understand, but hard for us to grasp. And that is that Jesus Christ always walks with you and me. Always. Even when we don't recognize him, even when we ignore him, even when we deny him, even when we betray him, even when we go on our own ways and try to walk off the path that he is on with us, he is always there. And like those men on the road to Emmaus, what we need to know and see and understand is even when we are unaware, even when we can't see him, he is there for us. But here's what happens to you and me. I've done it, and I'm guessing you've probably done it too, where if not, you may do it in the future. The minute you face hardship in your life, the minute I face hardship in my life, we want to pull it all back in. We want to reel it all back in. It's all about us. We want to control these things rather than allowing God to have the play in our lives and the patience that everything will work out. My father called this fly fishing faith. Fly fishing faith. He called it that. Now, what did he mean by that, fly fishing faith? Well, if you're familiar with fly fishing, you either wade into the river or you're there on the bank and you cast the line out, right? And that's kind of our lives. The analogy is that's our lives. We're there fly fishing, all right, as men and women of God. We're there. And then a tug comes on the line, and there's a fish that's biting. And in this analogy, that tug represents a challenge in your life and mine, some kind of defeat, some kind of disillusionment, some kind of despair, some kind of worry, some kind of anxiety, and it's tugging on us. And what's our immediate reaction? Our immediate reaction is this. We pull on that line because we want to control that challenge, that situation. We want to pull it all back towards us. We want to pull it back right towards us and deal with it all that way because we're human. But the good fly fisher, he or she knows, you got to give that fish some play sometimes. Sometimes you need to allow the fish to wear itself out till you can reel it in. And what my father would often say is, in the same way, we need to be patient with God in our lives. We need to be patient. We're not patient people. We live in a world of instant everything. Instant food in our microwaves, instant coffee at the drive-thru, instant this, instant that. And we treat God in the same manner. And that's an insult to God. That's a slap in the face to God. Because we want it all on our terms. Let it play out. Let the challenge play out. Stand up. If you have to stand up for what you believe in, stand up for something. If it's wrong, evil, bad, absolutely. But you got to let it play out. And then when the moment's right, everything will land the way it's supposed to be. But you and I have had those moments where we're dead set, we're dead determined that this was God's plan for my life, that I was convinced that this was God's plan for my life. And then it doesn't work out the way we think it does, and so we turn our backs on God. Jesus Christ walks with you and me all days and all ways. Even when we can't see him, even when we disappoint him, even when we are defeated, he always walks with you. He always walks with me. And this is the gift of Easter. And the gift of Easter has nothing to do with a date on a calendar that can be anywhere from March 27th to April 28th. It has nothing to do with the date on a calendar. It has nothing to do with how many people are in worship or at a church activity or event at every given time, because we have to trust the Holy Spirit is in charge and the Holy Spirit is working, bringing the people that need to be brought here, bringing people to other churches that need to be brought there, because we're part of the apostolic church. We're not the only game in town. And that those people will find salvation because we trust in God and have patience in our life. Even when we're not very patient people. You know, there's something interesting about the end of this passage today, and I'm coming down to the altar to talk about this because it has to do with what we're going to do in a few minutes. At the end of this passage, Jesus is only recognized by these men when they break bread together. And what the Christian church in totality has done as a whole with that passage across 2,000 years is they've made it all about the sacrament and about the Lord's Supper. Now, you got to remember something. This is the same day of the resurrection. We're only 3 days out from Jesus taking bread and wine of Passover and transforming it into something new. So in this, from Luke 24, it's not called the Lord's Supper. It's not called Holy Communion. It's not called a sacrament. He's simply breaking bread and drinking and eating with the disciples. Now, certainly it is true that God is present here, and God is present in our worship, and God is present in this room. That is certainly true. But I think the reason that Luke may have put that in his gospel is that when Jesus sat down with a simple, ordinary meal with these people, there they saw the risen Christ. When you have a meal with your family, there's Jesus. When you have a fight in your family, there's Jesus. When you have a problem at work and you can't resolve it, there's Jesus. When you're laughing with a friend, encouraging them and supporting them and recalling how God brought you through the past, there's Jesus. When you're crying, tears of grief, or tears of grief over something in your life that is no longer what it once was, there is Jesus. And he is here in this meal, but he's in the ordinary and every day. And it's my hope and my prayer that today and every day, every Sunday, that we recognize hope is not in the past. It is always about the present and the future. And that even when we can't see him, even when we're unaware, even when we're ignorant, Jesus is with us. Because we recall in the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread. He blessed that bread. He blessed it. He broke it. He gave it to the disciples and said, "Take and eat, because this is my body given for you." And then again, after supper, he took the cup and he blessed that and he gave it to the other disciples to drink. And he said, "This is now the blood of the new covenant, because it's shed in my blood given for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin." And for as often as we eat this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he returns again. And we pray the prayer he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. I'll invite the assistants forward, and as they come forward at this time, if you're visiting with us today, or it's your first time with us, we welcome you to the Lord's table. That's a free gift he gives to all who believe. Come forward and receive the bread, and then dip it into the chalice of wine, or hold it over the chalice of wine as you desire. That is God's gift to all of us who believe. The ushers will guide you forward to the appropriate station. God's gifts are
but holy trust in Jesus' name.
Thank you, Jesus, that you are our cornerstone, that the circumstances of our lives and the daily day-to-day interactions pale in comparison for the promises you have for us. Help us to take that eternal Easter power and live it here in the here and now. Help us to see that our hope is only in you, that everything and everyone else will sooner or later disappoint us, but that only you and you alone walk with us every day. We claim that Easter power, not only on Sundays, but each and every day of our lives. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Before we share in our benediction and closing song, we do want to remind you that next weekend, of course, we have a special opportunity to come and worship and all of the things that go on here every weekend. But also, 2 weekends from today is the beginning of our 50th anniversary celebration. It's going to be a great morning full of food and fun and fellowship. You'll be hearing much more about that in coming weeks and through your electronic communications. So invite a friend, share in that, and share in that special time together. And now, what we're going to do today for our benediction is something different. Usually, you're used to me sharing the benediction that Aaron gave to the people of Israel and sharing in that, the Aaronic benediction. But what we're going to do today is you're going to turn to someone that you don't know. Spouses, family members don't count, all right, for this one time. And you're just going to say, may God bless you this week, and I'm praying for you. And we're going to do that for just a minute or two, and then the band's going to kick in when they want to. Let's share that blessing with each other.
Shining light. for the glory of the risen King.
Conquered the grave.